Hachette Audio presents 100 Animals That Can Fucking End You, written and read by Mamadou Ndiaye. Introduction. If you've picked up this book, you're probably wondering how I ended up ruining ducks and otters for a living. So here's my character arc. In 2020, I was working as an environmental field technician when the pandemic hit. The day before I was laid off, I downloaded TikTok and started posting comedic skits out of boredom. On June 13th, I posted my first animal-related video about a giant moose. Have you seen what they look like next to a car? 2 weeks later, I had gained 100,000 followers, mostly on the heels of a video about prehistoric animals that make me seriously question God. That is the actual quote, by the way. I knew I was onto something, and after a few more weeks of traumatizing and educating people with random facts about the animal kingdom, that number rose to 500,000. Since then, I've been posting nonstop about interesting, weird, questionable, and downright disturbing aspects of the animal kingdom, all while making people laugh and likely sending a good number to counseling. A little over a year after that first video about the antlered grim reaper that is the moose, I had 10 million followers on TikTok, which I still can't wrap my head around. People often ask where my interest in animals came from, and honestly, there is no one answer. So here are 8 reasons why I am the way I am. Number 1, zoo books. You 90s kids might remember the commercials. I had them all. And fun fact, the elephant, or what I consider the most perfect animal, is the first book I ever received. Go figure. Number 2, the most extreme show was basically my Bible, and I watched it religiously. I wasn't allowed to watch TV on weekdays, but since the documentary series was technically educational, I could get away with it. If you watch this show and watch my videos, you can definitely see the influence. Number 3, Zoo Tycoon 2 was my first video game. Basically, you just build a zoo, and for some reason, 5-year-old me couldn't get enough of it. Also, I used to set the lions free and then watch them merk the guests, so yeah, I might have been a psychopath at one point. Number 4, I think I was like 7 when I fell for the complete book of animals. I had like hundreds of animal books, but for some reason, this one was my favorite. I had actually lost it for a year and a half in somebody's house in another state, and my 7-year-old mind did not know peace until I got it back. Number 5. I had a talking toy that would tell you facts about endangered species. I recently pulled it out, and it still works after all this time. Number 6. Zoo Vet was also one of my favorite games. I would honestly spend hours playing it. I couldn't tell my left from my right, but I could tell you how to check for tuberculosis in a camel or how to treat diarrhea in a chimpanzee. Number 7. Steve Irwin. But if you watch my videos, you already knew that. Number 8, National Geographic for Kids magazine, which I would get every month. But honestly, I really don't know. I didn't like animals because I had all those things. I had all those things because I already liked animals. I don't really know where it came from. I would make these little books full of animal drawings when I was like 3 years old, and I had no idea what made me do it. I think I was just a weird-ass kid, and some things just don't change. This book is filled with all kinds of interesting animals that can all activate your life insurance and put an RIP in front of your name. I've given them each a merk rating on a scale of 1 to 10, which takes into account an animal's tendency to aggression, how it interacts with other animals, how many fatal encounters with humans occur a year, how easily one could kill a human, and toxicity. But mostly it is my own admittedly biased opinion. African crested porcupine. Found in sub-Saharan Africa, North Africa, Italy, merk rating 4. Do you know how much of a cheat code you need to be to have lions and hyenas afraid of you? The African crested porcupine has about 30,000 reasons to make predators not choose violence. If one of those foot-long quills get in your skin, they'll swell up and then push through your flesh until they hit something important. A popular myth used to be that porcupines shoot their quills out as a form of self-defense. What they actually do is turn around and charge full force backwards into a potential predator, which is exactly how a lion, hyena, or even your pet dog can end up with a face full of painful quills. These rodents can injure lions so severely that their only option is to survive by hunting humans. There have been documented cases of crippled and emaciated lions going after people and their cattle after being injured in an encounter with a porcupine. Which is why the same apex predators that can hunt walking tanks like Cape Buffalo will hesitate to go after a beaver with blades growing out of its back. African elephant, found in Africa. Merk rating 10. Size does matter, and at 12,000 pounds and an average height of 10 feet at the shoulder, no land animal is bigger than the African elephant. Squaring up with one of these is canceling your subscription to living. And they're about it, too. Some of the largest land mammals on the planet, like hippos and rhinoceroses, can get knocked over like a bowling pin by a motivated adult elephant. And with a pair of tusks, they can easily one-shot any opponent foolish enough to try them. Also, there's nothing else like them. Bears, cats, and dogs look somewhat alike. Nothing on this planet looks like a big, overgrown walking tank with tusks and a ridiculously long nose. Speaking of which, that trunk has 40,000 muscles and can lift 700 pounds. This pachyderm has more muscles in its nose than your entire family tree combined. But best of all, African elephants are smart. They're intelligent enough to remember for years, probably decades, learn to use tools, solve problems, and they even have empathy. They've been known to value human lives enough to save them. In 2012, after Lawrence Anthony, dubbed the Elephant Whisperer, passed away, a herd of elephants traveled from miles to his home in an almost eerie funeral-like procession. While the myth that elephants see humans as cute isn't true, that apparently doesn't stop them from seeing some of us as family. At the end of the day, African elephants are one of the most intelligent, unique, and complex animals in the world. But with a tanky build, a trunk that can powerlift hundreds of pounds, and a devious mind, they can also be the world's most dangerous, when they want to be. Elephants are such powerhouses that they can take lives accidentally. In India, a herd of elephants got drunk off fermented fruit and, during their inebriated antics, destroyed 60 homes and unalived 3 people. Surviving an elephant. Notice I said elephant and not elephant attack, because truth be told, if an elephant decides it wants to hurt you, there isn't a force in nature that's going to save you. Forget being sent to Jesus, a pissed off elephant will send your soul straight to oblivion. Here are a few ways to improve your chances. If an elephant approaches you and its ears are relaxed, it's likely a mock charge. If the ears are pinned back, it's going to attack. Check the trunk. A relaxed trunk means it doesn't consider you a threat yet. A curled trunk means there's malicious intent and that an elephant is preparing to end you. Stay downwind. Elephants have poor eyesight but a strong sense of smell. Find a barrier. You want to keep something between you and the elephant. A car, a tree, a mailbox, literally anything's better than facing this guy defenseless. Don't turn your back on them. Elephants take this as a sign of fear or submission. They will hunt you down and give you the world's worst facelift. Distract the elephant. If it starts to approach you, throw a decoy object. You might be able to distract it long enough to escape. If that doesn't work, scream. Loud noise might fool the elephant into thinking you're a possible threat and leave you alone. If these methods work and you actually survive, make sure you play the lottery because you are one lucky motherfucker. African wild dogs, found in Southern Africa. Merk rating 7.5. These homicide hounds can run you down at as much as 44 miles per hour for 3 miles. African wild dogs are one of the most ruthless stat patterns in all of Africa. They're about the same size as the average pet dog, but there's one terrifying fact about them. They never get tired. And there can be up to 20 of them on your ass. The punishment for resisting is they tear your guts and intestines while you're still alive. And yes, that is one of the worst ways to die. On a continent with vicious animals like lions, hyenas, and worst of all, tourists, African wild dogs are the last things you want any smoke with. They actually decide as a pack whether to go on a hunt, and they vote by sneezing. If enough wild dogs sneeze, they decide to hunt. This means that the difference between a zebra going home to its family or getting its gut scrambled could really come down to a wild dog with a pollen allergy. Also, remember when I said they stat pad? They have one of the highest kill rates of any pack animal. Wolf packs have an estimated 14% hunting success rate, and lions flex an average of about 30%. But this African bush cujo has an 80% hunting success rate. So if a pack presses you, there's about an 8 out of 10 chance you're about to become one of the 8. Because they live in a dangerous environment, they're impossible to domesticate. Come at them with a rolled up newspaper and you might just end up on one. Pissed off. Weird fact, only the dominant male and female are allowed to lift their leg up to pee. The rest have to pee with all 4 on the ground. I don't know why this is a rule, but if a low-ranking dog pees with his leg up, he gets jumped, banished, and probably left to die. American bison, found in Western United States and Canada.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.